Massive recently flew a whole bunch of people to Malmo, Sweden to discuss the state of the game and how to make it better. I interviewed one of the people that was lucky enough to attend, so stick around if you want to hear how that event went down. Ladies and gentlemen, hello, it's Skill Up here with another Division video. As many of you will have known, the Elite Taskforce recently went down in Malmo, Sweden, an event that brought together a variety of community members and just like regular old players, people who don't have YouTube channels and Twitch streams and all the like, just people who play the game and are really passionate about it. I'm really pleased today to introduce a member that was part of the Elite Taskforce. He's Deep Fried Dave, a fantastic community member of terrific repute. He has done a variety of podcasts, including Rogue Agent Radio and most recently Collect What Remains. Is that what it's called, Dave?
Collecting What Remains.
Collecting What Remains. That's right. So he's got his silky smooth dulcet tones with us today to talk about what happened at the Elite Task Force, but to set really clear expectations. This is not about the output of that. Don't expect to get sort of juicy inside goss on the kind of, what we can expect for 1.4. This is very much about, how that conversation went down and like what was the structure of it and those sorts of things. So if that kind of stuff interests you, stick around. If not, totally cool. And that's it. So Dave, first of all, huge, huge welcome to you. Thank you so much for making the time.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm glad that you reached out. It was a great experience and definitely want to share the positivity of the different things that Massive is doing. So I'm glad we got a chance to talk.
Fantastic. And I'm just asking if you're feeling a bit jet lagged at the moment.
I've recovered, so it's been a couple of days, but I have a regimen that I use when I go overseas and it's still effective right now. So far so good.
Very nice. Very nice. So mate, I want to just start with the most important question first, because it's the question that gets most asked by people who are a little bit critical or skeptical of what this event was. So straight up, was this event a PR stunt in your opinion? And if not, why not?
Absolutely not. I can see how that perception becomes reality to some people. And I think a lot of that is they don't want to believe just that anything positive can be done by a gaming developer, and there's just a conspiracy behind that. And there's some people that are just skeptical of game developers in general, right? But this particular event was not a PR stunt. And if you look just solely at who was invited, there was 13 of us invited. And they'll tell you straightforward, and I'll tell you straightforward, five of them were content creators. And if you were to look down the list of people, even though there's not a list of people supplied, just because we want to protect those, not really protect, but give them the opportunity to...
Self-identify.
Exactly. Yeah, Thank you very much. So there's eight people that are not in the quote-unquote spotlight, that aren't creating content, that I've met through this process, that they're just hardcore gamers, or that have posted some great things on Reddit that were just good suggestions to making this game that they love into something even greater. And if you read through some of these comments on Reddit that are about the Elite Task Force, you can meet some of these people and realize that it's not just a PR stunt, it's not a capture event, or just a come out here and play our build and give us feedback type of thing. It's a legit event that nobody's done before. So I can see why people would think that it's just a PR stunt. It's very unique.
Sure. So let's maybe talk very quickly. So there's the eight people that, were not content creators, but who were the content creators? Because obviously those people put their names out there in a general sense. Who were the content creators that were invited?
Well, you can count myself as part of, as a podcaster, then obviously Marco Style, YouTuber. Then there was a couple streamers. So I am Chappie.
Yep.
Streamer, upper echelon.
Yep.
Streamer/YouTuber. And then Confliction, who's a streamer.
Okay, cool. Fantastic. And the profile of the sort of non-content creators, was there a good mix of like, I'm really interested to know, were there people that were sort of casual players, hardcore players, PvPers, PvEers? Like, how did that sort of shake out in terms of the way people play the game?
It was very interesting to me because I guess we definitely had a casual feel for some of the guys. But if I look at hours played, I don't want to call that a casual player, but let's be honest, hardcore players definitely have more time to invest, and they're there not only because they enjoy the game, but they have that time to invest, and that's where we get our hardcore player base from. So if you look at a casual player, I consider myself a casual player. It doesn't mean that other people that were there don't understand the casual player's needs, but I'll say that I have 18 days played between my characters. You know, I'm a 40-year-old father of two who works, and I balance my gaming. I call myself casual core because I'm hardcore when I do game. It's my primary source of entertainment. But so if you look at, let's call the rest of the group hardcore, there's a lot of PvP, straight PvP hardcore players, which I hadn't met too many, so that was a really interesting experience. So we'll say four or five of them, and then there were a couple that were definitely hardcore PvP and PvE content, and then there was a few outliers that really stuck out, which I think really made the group what it was there were two players that were hardcore. When I say hardcore, I mean just in hours invested and know the ins and outs of the game, which is really important for a balance pass or a quote-unquote changing the core experience, as this is. But there was two solo players that they haven't even done any incursions because of their play style and how they play solo, that some of them don't even matchmake, but there were two that were solo players that were hardcore solo players, which I think is a very important aspect of this. And then another player that it was PvP group activity. I mean, he's the guy that's in MMOs, you know, taking people through raids and in this case, pickup groups, taking them through incursions, heroic incursions for the first time. So I definitely think that Massive got it right, and there was a great mix of all different types of play styles, and the discussions went wildly different, but was an awesome thing to see develop.
That's awesome. That's really encouraging. Because, yeah, I mean, obviously the composition of that kind of group would be so important to make sure the conversation covered off all the bases. So it's really great to know that Massive put that thought in and got that composition right. That's just awesome. So obviously, like, you know, you get these people together. That's great. But then obviously you need to build the right agenda for them. So maybe you could just talk us through at a very high level, what was the overall structure for the agenda for the 3 days?
And that was interesting to me. I have a management background. So what I do, part of my job is program management. And I've been through and I've even conducted and facilitated these brainstorming activities, you know, these focus groups, these types of events that are really geared toward smaller groups in order to generate ideas and production, right? So I had my own vision coming into it. So you take that, but then you take a step back. And the unknowns when you're coming into this, myself thinking, well, they could do a rotating focus group. They could do these small teams with a heat map. You know, there's all these different like stereotypical management style. You read a textbook and understand the procedure. But the interesting thing, the one factor that I didn't know was that keeping in mind that when they announced, which was, you know, quite frankly, I'll say a ballsy announcement to say, we know the game's broke. We're going to put our DLC on hold, and we're going to spend the time to change the core experience. When they said that, that was about 2 to 3 weeks prior to this event, right? Well, one thing that I didn't take into consideration is obviously they're a big AAA title developer. They have their own ideas and thoughts and have been reaching out to the community already and monitoring it. Well, when we got there, they had already had some ideas and almost a build together. So with that, that kind of changes the structure right away. So we get there, there's introductions, you know, all of us individually introduce ourselves to the developer team. And if you're not too familiar with how a team like this is put together, there are different developers who head up different facets of the game. So there is a loot slash economy team. There's an enemy AI NPC team. There's a weapons and gear team. There's all these different developers that are part of these different teams. So you're in a room and you're introducing yourselves and kind of showing what your background is within the game, and what you want to bring to the table with these discussions. So that introduction happened, and then we broke off into what ideally it was the best scenario for this, is we broke off into a group, and it was just the community managers, Hamish and Yannick, and ourselves, the Elite Task Force, the 13 of us in a room, and we just straight talk, what are our issues with the game? What are the things that we think are most quote-unquote broken or need the most attention? So we all identified our top three things, and put those on, you know, this is the typical, this is where you could get into a textbook and read it, right? You all, everyone put their top three things on a post-it. We put all of our post-its on the big whiteboard, and they were all organized in a heat map type of style to where you could see where the trends were, right? So anyone that had their loot was their biggest issue. All of their post-its were going in one area. And then we each individually explained our item on why it affected us, which was very important to understand because those were the play styles of everyone. Loot affects me differently as a casual core player than it does a someone who's hardcore PvP or someone who's hardcore PvE group oriented. So we got all that on the table, and it's important to say that all of those notes were on this huge whiteboard that stayed on there the entire time. So as we're going through these different activities, you could look up there and say, you know, that was something that we talked about. So that was the beginning of it. That led into presentations. So each of those developer groups that I mentioned, whether it's enemy AI or loot or gear and weapons, I believe there's four of them, and skills was the fourth. They each group gave us an hour to hour and a half long presentation. And this presentation was very detailed and very important because it showed you exactly the state of the game today. Like, where are, let's just use it as an example, where is difficulty and enemy health? You know, let's look at what it is today. Now let's look at what we intended it to be. Let's look at how we got to the place that we're not happy with, to where, why we're here to fix it. And then let's talk about their solutions, proposed solutions. So we came to this to look at their initial proposed solutions. So we went through each one of those and then played an initial build that they had put together with their proposed solutions. Now, all of this seems like, and even myself, I'll say a little bit like, well, you know, we're coming here just to look at what they've put together. You know, this really isn't turning into a feedback and let's make some changes type of discussion. The build we played was probably 25% complete of the suggestions that they had put forth. So that's when it really kicked up a notch after that. We play the build. We group back up the next day, and it's almost 2 hours. Now we have all the developers in the room, and it's straight feedback. Each developer wanting to know, hey, what did we think about the loot? What did we think about the enemy, whatever? You know, all these different factors that were in this build and trying to get down to the nuts and bolts on what we thought as a player going into it compared to what the game is today. And that was a very important part. And the good thing to really comment on is that this was a spectacular group for engagement. I don't know how it worked out this way because I've been in these groups before, but everyone spoke up, wanted their two cents heard. They didn't like it. They told you they didn't like it. They told you why. And everyone's reasoning is different because you can take a little bit of, take it personal when it's your play style, right? So there was such good feedback and conversation just from that alone. It really helped promote the last part of the day. I won't say the last part of the day, but the whole third day was spent in workshops to where we broke off into two teams, 6 and 7, to make it small group size. And there was private conversations with the developers. So we had a whole conversation on skills with a small group and gear sets with a small group and enemy scaling and mechanics with a small group. So that allowed us for 2 hours each, 2 to 3 hours, to talk about the in-depth mechanics in the game, what can be improved, and really get to the nuts and bolts of what can we change to make this a better game. And that's when it really becomes a reality that this isn't just a PR exercise, or this isn't just let's get some validity to the things that we already know. It's not, we read Reddit, now you're just repeating it. It's getting down into the details that you can't get on a forum, that you can't get meeting one-on-one. It's sitting down to the level that I was in the skills talk. And just an example, it would be, let's take one thing out of the air of, let's take one skill and call it a ballistic shield. Well, now you have in this group, you have a hardcore PvP player, you have a hardcore solo player, you have myself who's casual core, and you have all these different people who have different builds and different play styles, and they all have input. And yes, it can be varied and it should be varied, but those are the types of results that this type of event really is looking for, and they were there. So overall, the right people, and I think the structure of it was great for the conditions. So
So just to sort of summarize what you said that, you know, introduce yourselves, talk about the state of the game from it. I get the feeling there was a bit of stats involved in that. Like, let's talk about really where things are at. And that was presented to you by the developers. You got your hands on a build that was very early on in the piece, sort of 25% complete. And then you kind of had the chance to go back and sort of through a workshop process, really refine out specific ideas for how to make the game better. Is that the sort of general flow?
That's exactly it.
Nice, nice. Okay, cool. So I'm really interested to know what kind of sort of, if any, were there any sort of parameters set for you during this? Like, was it a case of they said, look, here's what we can realistically do in 1.4, so let's try and work in that? Or was it a case of like, let's just go blue sky thinking, let's go any and everything is on the table? Like, how did that really work?
There were parameters set in a couple different ways. I guess the first part of the parameters is, and they've mentioned it before, is 1.4. The intention and the goal of 1.4 is X, Y, and Z. You know, and we've heard it the same phrase 100 times, and people have said, if I hear improve the core experience one more time, you know, I'm going to snap. But that's what we were there for. So it wasn't about content. It was about it was about the core experience and bringing back the feeling that you got while you played levels 1 through 30, you know, leveling up. And obviously they've said that in the last day of the game and repeatedly, that's what it was about. The second parameter I would say was, let's take bug fixes and glitches or whatever you want to call it out of this conversation. Mm. Those are going to be addressed on their own.
To be clear on that, is that, so I'm going to assume that it's, you know, Massive knows that those are important. It wasn't about them not prioritizing them. It was about saying that that wasn't part of this conversation. Is that correct?
No, thank you for correcting me, because
I can just hear the comment section being like, oh, here we go, Massive. Yeah. They don't give a shit about bugs. You know what I mean?
Right. No, and we weren't there to identify bugs, right? So they did a recently, you know, they've started this agent intel portion on their forums. And I'm not sure, I really urge people to go there if you want a voice, because it is getting read. So one of the first topics, actually the first topic they put on the Agent Intel part of the Ubisoft forums was, give us your top 10 bugs that just, you know, you think are really hindering your game experience. And there's hundreds and hundreds of entries on there. And they are reading those, they understand those. And I don't want to guess, or I don't want to say, to the level of detail that they are going into these bugs, but 1.4 is about improving the core experience, as they keep mentioning, and bug fixing is a large portion of that. We weren't there to talk about how to fix bugs. They know the bugs are there. They play it. They read their forums. We were there to kind of work together on discussions on how to create solutions that will apply to all different play styles. So definitely a priority.
I see. Right. Okay, cool. I mean, I'm really interested to hear about your impressions of the Massive guys. And obviously, I'm not asking for specifics about people or whatever else, but, you know, one of the biggest criticisms that I think Massive gets is that they just don't listen. You know, if they were listening, how could they have created a game that was this broken, right? And that's, I'm very crudely paraphrasing some of the more negative comments that I receive in my comment section across Reddit, etc. But the point I think that people like this are making is that, you know, is there truly a group of people at Massive that are listening to player concerns, or is there not? Because I think that's something that pops up a lot from what I hear.
It was very apparent from, you know, we talked about just from the get-go, us as the Elite Task Force identified our biggest concerns were what we thought were faults in the game. So that was very important for us to do, because we could see it on there. We could see all of these things on the board. It was all written out for us, staring us in the face, and there was a lot of overlap. And this projected, even yourself put a video together, right? These are the top, I believe, was it 10 things that the community was an outcry for changes in the game when they were on the break, right? So, yes, a lot of that was in sync to that. So if you look at that, and then, I mean, that was, it was a gut check, honestly, for them and for us at that point to put that on the board and then go through the presentations. And their presentations, when they started showing solutions, you know that they're listening to the community. You know, I can tell you how to, I have a problem with the enemy scaling. Now, you're very numbers oriented. You know, you definitely have you like in Marco and even I'll say a Naked Cowboy, who was a great part of the Elite Task Force, which I'll call Little Skill Up. He was there.
Little Skill Up. Wow. Yeah. That's yeah. awesome. Yeah. I wonder how much he likes that.
Oh no, I know that he'll appreciate it. So he brought your name up level like Skill Up, but he understands those points, and they're definitely heard. And if you ask him, you know, they'll say, "Hey, we want to talk to you specifically. We like your ideas." And that's why he was there for some Reddit posts. Mm-hmm. So they listen to the community. And you can see that in the solutions that they were suggesting. They weren't telling us these are the solutions. They were suggesting them. And when we saw them, we could definitely tell that they were based on community feedback. And even they read the Reddit every day. I know Reddit posts. I don't comment on there because I'm not, I'm a sodium free gamer. I don't like to participate in that, sure, but I do read it. And as we talk about Reddit, and even at dinner a couple nights, I'm talking to a couple of developers about Reddit, and you can just tell because they're calling out posts or comments that were impacted to them on the part of the game that they work on that I've read before. So I know. I mean, it's probably, I don't want to say it's written in the standard protocol, but they're on Reddit, they're listening, they're on the forums, and it's not just the community managers. You know, you'll see Hamish and Yannick replying to things on there, but they are all very much in tune with what the community is, what the outcry is on certain things. So I know that they're part of that.
Sure. So hey, I'm really interested to hear, you know, you touched on it briefly, but I just want to come back to it again. You know, how much of this, in your view, was about reviewing what was already there versus how much of it was coming up with entirely new stuff? And do you feel that balance was right?
I think the balance was perfect because if I look back at it, and like I said, I had some reservations initially when they said, well, okay, we have something together that we want to show you. And initially I was like, huh, you know, are we here just to validate it? But the more that I looked at it, it was definitely the right mix. I'm not a game developer. I don't code. I don't know the intricacies needed to produce, you know, an outcome. All I can tell you is I don't get enough loot. I can't tell you the best way to get there. I can give you suggestions, but the capacity and the limitations, which are always there, and we gave suggestions where it was sometimes, I hear you, that's not possible with the way we have set up, but what if we did this?
Okay.
There was a lot of that discussion. So once it boiled down to what they showed us on some of the things, it was a question at the end. Do you think this is a good solution to resolve X, Y, and Z? It was not a, here's our solution, what do you think of it? It was a, here is something that we came up with. Do you think it's a good solution? If not, why? How can we tweak it? We're talking about the test server hasn't even been released yet. This is a team that has now been afforded the opportunity to push other content aside and solely focus on, you know, updating and improving something that they're passionate about. They're very much receptive on any feedback that we could give them about what they've come up with, because they know it's not concrete. They think it is by the community feedback, but there wasn't enough there yet to say that we came in definitely with the feeling that we could impact it, and you could see that change. We talked about things during those presentations that the next day when we started workshops, it was very apparent that they were listening, and you could see changes on paper that we had mentioned the day before already getting put into an action plan. So that alone tells me that we were there to help improve the experience and not just there to validate ideas that they had.
Sure. I guess one of the other sort of skepticisms that bubbles up is that, hey, listen, 1.4, don't expect much. It's going to be small time changes. You know, it's minor tweaks, you know, that Massive are sort of trying to build it up in the hope of holding on to players. But realistically, it's going to be just changing a bit of HP on the enemies and maybe a bit more loot and that's it. Without giving away any specifics, what's your sense on how big 1.4 is looking?
You know, before, I'd never played Diablo.
Okay.
I'll just say that, but I'm very familiar with 2.0, and I actually researched that, you know, and if you are or not a Diablo player, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, because I know that you've played quite a bit of Diablo, is that right?
Yeah.
So 2.0 was a big change, right? It was something that fundamentally changed how you played the game, how you got loot, how the loot was given to you, how you modified it. It was everything. And would you correct me in saying, was it 90% loot based? Is that a correct assumption?
Yeah, I would say that. Yeah, generally, yeah, very. In fact, almost 98% loot based at that point. It was, okay. I guess, the change at that time was described as loot 2.0. Correct. They didn't really change things like abilities and level design, etc. It was about what is the loot economy and what is the nature of loot itself, and those things were completely torn up, and we started all over again.
And that was a fairly big change for that IP, right? I mean, from 100%. What I could tell, it was fundamental to the future of the game and the DLC following it, right? And if you look at the parallel in the Division, that was just loot. So now you start talking about all these things that they're bringing up on State of the Game, and they're talking about you know, the gap between your average player and your top 1% player of difficulty. You're talking about enemy scaling. You consider that loot change, and then exponentially you take that against all of these things that they continue to tell you that are going to change, and you can start to comprehend what is changing. It's going to change the way that you play the game. It's going to change the way that you know the game. Mm-hmm. It is going to be a different game. Cool. And I think I read some an article when I was doing some research prior to coming into this. I felt like it was just going to be a total game changer. And from what they told you, it was going to be an overhaul, right? They told you it was going to be a revamp. So you start hearing those words. It's not just let's not change some HP and increase the drops in these areas. I don't want to say that I had read some comments from a certain Forbes writer about Diablo. You wouldn't be surprised to see the similarities between the article that he wrote about Diablo and previous to Loot 2.0, and then the Division as it is today, and talking about the rebirth of Diablo. And I think this is going to be a rebirth for the Division, just because it's going to change fundamentally how we play the game today. But more importantly, it's going to change, and I want to say more importantly, because it is important that we gain back, you know, that player base that we've lost for various reasons. It's important to us hardcore players as well. But I think that players that would come back to the game are going to see a totally different game. So all those things aside, I say go watch Skill Up's video about the top 10 things you can do while you're waiting for 1.4.
Nice. Thanks for that little plug. Appreciate it, Dave.
Yeah, there you go.
So, Dave, one question that's really important was that the PTS, the player test server, has been delayed. And the guys are claiming that one of the reasons that they delayed that was because of the feedback they received from the Elite Task Force. So I just wanted to sort of ask you about that. You could maybe give us a bit of background on how that came about.
Well, I think that it's important. It's a tricky topic for them, right? There have been delays. They've had to communicate these types of things in the past. And the last thing I think they want to do when they're going through this transition of putting out a 1.4 is come to the community and say, we've had another delay. However, in light of what they are trying to accomplish with this Elite Task Force, I think it's just speaks volumes to what we're trying to accomplish here with this event. So we played it. We all gave honest feedback, and it wasn't all positive. I mean, people keep saying that, or there's a buzz that we just, you know, we're showering them with all of the of gratitude and all of these positive things. You know, it wasn't about that. There were some real conversations and some real feedback. And one of the things that stuck out to me is that when we're playing this, and we all were able to import our builds, our characters. So we're talking about this and we're going through it, and we have all of these questions and concerns, and you take people's characters that they've invested so much time with and they put them in this totally new environment. It raises a lot of difficult questions. And on top of that, just the discussions that we've had about 1.4 and what it should show the community, and what it, you know, they're saying that it's going to address these types of things, and it's going to bring light to some of the concerns that you have. If it's not doing that, yes, it's still a PTS. We know what the PTS is there for. It's to help improve the game. It's to help find these things that need correcting before it goes live. Sometimes that doesn't, you start streaming and that doesn't always transfer over well. So I think really saying that we were in conversations about loot when they made the announcement upstairs from us, right above us, about how the PTS was going to be delayed. And that was on the third day. And I think it was important, or the second day, excuse me. And I think it was important to know that it was an impact of our conversations, and they took it to heart. And I think it's a good result and a good indicator of what's going to come out of this event. So
cool. Yeah, all right. Well, thank you for that. Because as I said, the community definitely had some questions around that. So I just wanted to sort of set the record straight with regards to how that all went down. Hey, I guess last question is, you know, is it a case that everything is going to drop all at once? Is 1.4 going to happen and there it is? Or is it a case of, you know, you think that there's a bit of a longer road to redemption here? Is it going to happen in stages? You know, what is your sense for how long this transformation is going to take? Because I guess some people are sort of saying 1.4 is going to be the beginning, and then it's going to happen through sort of, you know, in ideations after, you know, patch after patch, making it better. While some people think that, you know, 1.4 is just going to drop and there it is. What's your view with regards to what's the timeline for this going forward?
Well, I think the 1.4 is to address the main concerns of the game right now. So if anyone plays a game right now, loot's a main concern. The enemy scaling and that feel of 1 to 30 is a concern, and that scaling difficulty is a concern. There's much more involved in 1.4, but I think if you want to pave the way forward for future content like survival, those are the core experiences that you want to get right, so that players come back the next day feeling rewarded and not punished. And those are the things that they're focusing on right now. And there's a big focus for that. And an example, they've said it several times. Now, there are some metas in the Dark Zone with PvP that the Dark Zone and PvP is not getting directly addressed. We did not talk about Dark Zone.
You didn't talk about the Dark Zone at all while you were there?
Not at all. That was okay. And the reason being is it was very, and they've been very clear that the Dark Zone is not something that's going to be addressed in 1.4. And when they say that, they just mean we're not looking at the Dark Zone and figuring out the rogue system or the mechanics or anything like that. That's for a later patch. I'd love to see it come in 1.5 with survival, and I don't know if that's the case. We didn't talk about that at all. But with the things that are in the PvP meta today, we're talking about shotguns and sentry and reclaimer. Those types of things are going to get naturally fleshed out with the core experience changes. So no, they're not directly touching those things. By changing these core experiences, it's going to change, which is going to make it a living change. So this patch isn't going to be the end all be all. You know, crafting isn't getting touched on this patch. You know, vendors type of thing isn't getting touched. The Dark Zone. So it's going to be definitely something that they need to progress through and stay up on it, and maybe a little better than they have been in the past few months, right? But this is laying the foundation for any new content. And we can probably all agree that they did a poor job of setting themselves up for new content and for new gear scores and new levels. And I think it's important on this 1.4, which they recognize that they reset the foundation for the future so they can improve upon it more easily. And I think that they have that figured out.
Awesome. Fantastic. Well, Dave, it's so good to speak to you about your experiences. It's so good to hear just how well it went. You know, I've always been quite pumped about 1.4, but just you know, having this chat with you has just made me even more excited. So look, thank you so much for taking the time to share your experiences with me and with, you know, people listening. Really, really appreciate it, mate.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate it. I enjoy talking about, I mean, both passionate about the division. So anytime I can talk about the division, I'm grateful. And I am excited for 1.4. And I do think that, you know, don't state me on it's going to appease every player, but I know that this is a huge step in a positive direction. I know that the team over there at Massive is very passionate about the game and hear our feedback. And I know this event was definitely worth everyone's time and it wasn't a PR stunt. It was definitely taken to heart. And that was, you could see that in many, many different layers. So I'm excited to see what all of this, what the results are from the task force event. So
awesome. So, hey, if anyone wanted to sort of connect with you or listen to your podcast, how do they do that?
You can find me on Twitter at Deep Fried Dave. And then as far as the podcast, Collecting What Remains is a podcast dedicated to division lore. It's myself and Tinks. And if you're familiar, if you've heard Tinks, you've also heard for her from Bombshell Jackets, a division podcast that I believe you were a guest on.
I was a victim of the Bombshell Jacket ladies. So it was a very interesting experience. I'll definitely return, but I think I'll need a good few months to recover. So
that talk to a therapist, do those certain things.
That's right. Totally.
Awesome podcast. But you can find our podcast, Collecting What Remains, on Twitter at Division Lore. So those are the best places to reach us. So fantastic. Thanks again for the opportunity to come on.
Fantastic. Dave, thank you again. You're an absolute legend, mate. And I really look forward to staying in touch and seeing how it all goes. And to everyone out there listening, thanks very much for your time. Hope you've enjoyed this discussion. If you liked it, do drop it a like. And if you haven't subscribed, you can, of course, subscribe for end-to-end division coverage, especially in the lead-up to the big 1.4 megaton explosion that's about to hit. Very excited. Thanks very much for watching. Take good care, and I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.